So in the previous class, we started with the first chapter, design for static loading and dynamic loading. And in that we started with knowing what exactly is strength. So strength means basically the stress the metal can take up to failure. So it basically, in general sense, we can call it as capacity. If a person can carry a load of some 70 kg, okay. So if you ask him to carry a load of 50 kg, 40 kg, 60 kg, he can easily carry, okay. But once you give him a weight of 80 kg, so it is more than his capacity. So strength is nothing but basically a capacity of a material. So you should be keeping in mind that unlike in our day-to-day life, where we will be using strength as a load, in our mechanical engineering, we will be calling strength as stress, or it will be having units as stress basically here. So we'll be finding out the load by area basically. So strength in static loading is basically a constant value. It depends upon only the material. It doesn't depend upon anything else. And if it is a ductile material, it will be equal to its yield stress value. And if it is a brittle material, it will be equal to ultimate stress value. Understanding everybody? So those are the two values corresponding to different types of materials. So based upon whether it is a ductile material or a brittle material, it will be either yield stress value or ultimate stress value respectively. Now coming to the dynamic loading, so I said that in dynamic loading, strength decreases over time. So strength decreases over time, and obviously, like, it's already you people be having the idea that strength is always strength will be depending upon the material. So how the strength is going on decreasing over time depends upon the material in the first place, and also the type of load acting on that. So this point is very, very important for today's class as well. That's the reason why I'm repeating once again. So I would like to explain this thing again by using some example. Imagine you are making two bridges. So there are two bridges. So both the bridges are of same dimensions, everything. Okay. So they're having same width, same number of pillars, all these things here. So same bridges. Okay. So this is bridge number one, this is bridge number two. But you are using for different purposes. Imagine this particular bridge is for vehicles which can travel on road. Okay, so for buses, cars, it's basically a road bridge here. But this particular bridge, let's take it as a railway bridge. So tracks are there, so it's a railway bridge here. So why I am taking this difference that this is a road bridge and this is a railway bridge is the type of load, the type of dynamic load that is coming up to or coming onto the bridge number one and bridge number two will be different. So though you have made with same material, though you have made with the same dimensions, everything is same, but here the type of load acting is different. The type of load means both are dynamic loads only, but how they are acting is different. For example, you take the variation of load with respect to time for this particular road bridge here. So if you take this particular road bridge, maybe like the, let's assume the traffic is like something like this, it not go to negative. So let's take it as like it is like this. Okay. So the variation of load with respect to time is basically in this way for this particular road bridge. Now when coming to this railway bridge, let's assume that this particular load is varying in some other way. Let's assume. Okay. So both are acting in a different way. Okay, at some point of time you see that it is having some maximum value or some value here, but this value is different with respect to the value in this particular bridge here. Understand? So load variation in bridge number one and the load variation in bridge number two, both are different. So what happens is the way in which, or if you are finding out the strength value after some amount of time, after some years, maybe 10 years if you take it, we cannot expect strength to be same in this particular bridge and also this particular bridge. Understood? Though we are using same material, same dimensions and everything, though we are using everything to be same, but here as the loads are different in bridge number one and bridge number two, we will be having different strengths at some point of time. So this is what I would like to convey here. Is it clear to everybody? Any doubt here? Everybody understood that, like, for dynamic loading, the type of dynamic load acting is also very, very important. Is it clear to everyone? So you can copy also at least these two statements. If you're not copying this particular diagram, at least you copy these statements so that when you refer the notes, it will be there. Kindly copy everyone. So I hope everybody have understood the strength regarding static loading and dynamic loading. So this we have discussed in the first class itself. After this, we started with the dynamic loading case, and we understood strength will be decreasing over time. And we have seen that the least value of endurance strength below which the component will be having infinite life, we called it as endurance limit. So endurance limit we can say as endurance strength corresponding to infinite life. Okay, so every strength, endurance strength, will be corresponding to some amount of life or fatigue life basically, but if it is corresponding to infinite life, we call it as endurance limit. So endurance limit is the most safest value here. If you are creating a stress which is less than endurance limit, then the component will never ever fail. But unfortunately, for every component, endurance limit will be very, very less. So most of the cases, 99.99% cases, we are going to have loadings which will be causing stresses which will be higher than endurance limit itself. That's the reason why every component will be having a particular finite life itself. It's not that like we are using some component and it will be forever. Okay. So Saurabh Kumar is asking the doubt that, sir, depends also on area of contact. Saurabh Kumar, first of all, we are talking about strength here. So in this case here, as we are discussing about strength, okay. So at the basic level, whatever we discussed, this is completely right here. In the coming slides or coming concepts, we are going to discuss in a more detailed way about endurance limits. Okay. So there will be understanding that one. Clear? But area of contact, if you are asking about area of cross section, so that will no longer be a valid reason to affect the stress, affect the strength. The reason is we are not dealing with a load. Okay, we are already dealing with stress value. So stress is already load per unit area of cross section. So area of cross section is already taken care. Understood? So we are already dealing with strength value here, which is load per area. So we are always dealing with the ratio of load to area here. Understood? Okay then. So let's go ahead. So we have studied about stress concentration after that, and we understood at the end of the lecture, the previous class, that our aircrafts will be having oval shaped windows just to avoid stress concentration. And we studied about few terms like stress concentration factor and all these things, and we understood that due to stress concentration, stress increases by a factor, and strength decreases by a factor, and that particular factor we call it as stress concentration factor or theoretical stress concentration factor. And we also understood that theoretical stress concentration factor depends only upon the geometry. It doesn't depend upon material. That is the biggest drawback of this particular stress concentration factor, which we call it as theoretical stress concentration factor. In today's lecture, we are going to see how to modify that and take into consideration the material parameter into the calculations here, because strength always should be depending upon material. So if you are dealing with stress increasing, or if you are dealing with increasing of stress or decreasing of stress, definitely should be taking care of the material. So if your theoretical stress concentration factor is, as our theoretical stress concentration factor is not considering or not taking material into consideration, then that means our theoretical stress concentration factor might not be able to give us the correct results or correct calculations every time. So that will be more clear at the end of today's lecture. So let's go ahead with our next concept here. Okay. Kindly put this particular title, Design for Static and Dynamic Loads Under Stress Concentration. And we understood what exactly is static load, what exactly is a dynamic load. Also, we understood about stress concentration, what exactly is stress concentration. So now we are going to relate both the concepts. So if you would like to design a component under static loading, under stress concentration, how you should be designing. If you'd like to design a component under dynamic loading with stress concentration, how you should be designing. That you'll be getting to know from this concept here. Okay, kindly put the title, Design for Static and Dynamic Loads Under Stress Concentration. How to deal with a component which is undergoing static loading and also stress concentration. How to design or deal with a component which is undergoing dynamic loading and also stress concentration. That is what we are going to see here. Okay, so we have discussed that we have two types of materials, and also we have discussed that we have two types of forces, okay, or two types of loads. So if I list out, we have ductile material and we have brittle material. And in terms of loads, we have static load and also we have dynamic load. So if you take combination of a material and a load, then we'll have four combinations: ductile, static, ductile, dynamic. Next we have brittle, static and brittle, dynamic. So we have four combinations here. Understand? So let's take these four combinations and do the analysis or understand how we should be designing or how we should be approaching for designing of a component under that combination of the material and the loading here. Okay, so I'm listing out the four cases here. So this part of this particular concept is not well explained in V.V. Bhandari textbook. So it was little bit explained in a very jumbled way. So I'm going to explain you the complete concept in a tabular form. So you have the every data in single page itself. Okay, but listen carefully. Please don't miss what exactly I'm telling. So first combination, if you take ductile under static. So second combination, brittle and static. Third combination, ductile and dynamic. Fourth combination, brittle and dynamic. So I hope you people have understood how we got these four combinations. Okay, so two materials, two types of loads, so 2 into 2, four combinations. Okay, so we already know what would be the value of strength without stress concentration. Okay, so ductile under static loading. So in static loading, we already know if it is ductile material, we have yield strength as the strength here, and for brittle material, we have ultimate strength as the strength value here. Okay, ultimate stress as a strength value, or yield stress value, strength value for brittle and ductile respectively. I hope there is no doubt regarding these two here. Yes, okay. And when it comes to dynamic loading, whether it is ductile or brittle, so strength will be endurance strength. We call it as endurance strength. So that will be depending upon material to material and also type of the loading. But if you see, for any material or any type of loading, endurance limit is the most safest value. Okay, so we expect failure not to happen, right? So theoretically speaking, okay, so we can write down that endurance limit is the strength of the material in dynamic loading here. Any doubt regarding these four answers here, or whatever written in the second column here? What will be the effect of loading frequency on stress concentration? What will be the effect of loading frequency on stress concentration? As if this part is over, no doubt at all how these four things came. So whatever we had discussed in the previous class, I just applied here. That's it. Okay, so even the next column, whatever I'm going to fill, this is also based upon the previous class only. That is, I'm going to write down the strength value with the stress concentration. Okay, strength value with stress concentration. Okay, now you guys know that we have studied about a factor called as theoretical stress concentration factor. So if you have a strength of some value without stress concentration, then with stress concentration, strength decreases by the factor. So decreases by the factor means we should be dividing by the particular factor. So because this factor will be greater than 1 only, so if you are multiplying with the factor, definitely it will increase. Okay, it's a meaningless thing to say that due to stress concentration, strength is increasing. It never happens. Okay, so SYT by KT. Anyways, we already discussed how it comes out to be SYT by KT in the previous class itself. Now, in the same way, if you write down for the other three cases, it will become SUT by KT, SE by KT, SE by KT here. So, I already told you that our theoretical stress concentration factor is having limitation basically. So that limitation is, it depends upon only geometry or dimensions, that's it. If you take a cubical box having some hole inside it, which is made up of some aluminium, okay, aluminium material. You take another cubical box, same dimensions, everything, at the same location, blow hole or whatever the small hole is there, which is causing stress concentration, is present. But everything is same, the only difference is metals are different. So in that case also your KT value will remain same. Okay, so that's the limitation of stress concentration factor or theoretical stress concentration factor. So here we are going to see how we are going to modify it, where you should be using KT, where you should not be using KT. All those things we are going to learn in this particular concept here. Any doubt regarding the second column? Okay, so this is the ideal answer which we are expecting from our calculations, but this is not completely true from experiments. So we are going to check it from experiments here. So this particular result is basically only theoretical. Okay, and this thing is experimental. So strength with stress concentration, stress concentration, so which was checked experimentally. So this is very, very important here. Okay, so this is checked experimentally here. So I'm gonna give you why it is coming up in that way, or why it is coming different at this value, and give you the answers here. So if a question is given, you should be using these values, because we should be using the correct formula or correct answer, or should be giving the calculations using correct answer there. Okay, okay, fine, let's go ahead. So if you take this, if you take a ductile material and test under static loading, okay, so I'll make you people to write down. First of all, just understand here. Okay, I will write down here, you can copy below this particular table. So this is a cylindrical specimen, okay, some cylindrical specimen having some one blow hole here. Okay, so it's having a hole, so it is experiencing some tensile load here. So this is basically a static load. So I'm going with this particular case, first case here. So in the first case, what's happening is, so when you apply a load, that will be giving rise to stress. So if you take this particular area of cross section, stress will be some value. Okay, if you take stress at this cross section, it will be more than this case here. So if you take this as first cross section, it's a second cross section, sigma at 2 will be higher than sigma at 1. Is it right? Yes, I hope though there is no doubt, because in the vicinity of the blow hole there will be stress concentration. So stress concentration means stress will be increasing than the nominal value. Okay, so we'll be having higher value of stress here. So if yielding happens in the material, first and foremost yielding will happen at this location only, because remaining all the places we are having same value of stress here, but at this location we are having higher value of stress. So here yielding will happen. Yielding means basically what? Yielding means it's not breaking of the material. Yielding means plastic deformation. Okay, the metal will try to elongate permanently or contract permanently, change its dimensions permanently. So it is opposite of elastic. So what happens is, yielding is happening only at this location. Yielding is not happening at the other locations. Okay, at that instant when yielding started here. If you apply more amount of load, you can create a situation where yielding is happening at every location. Okay, but I'm not going with that particular case. I'm just going, or I'm talking about that particular instant where yielding started at this location here. So when yielding starts at this location, metal will be trying to elongate or contract permanently. So due to this tendency of permanently elongating or contracting, what happens is this particular blowhole will try to close up. So how it is getting closed up? The reason is due to elongation or contraction, what happens is the metal will try to undergo some slight amount of deformation, which will make this particular blowhole to almost close up. So this particular blowhole will disappear. Understand, this is the experimental result, or this is the way the metal is behaving. So you should be understanding here. Okay, so ideally speaking, I should be showing you or I should be taking you to a lab, and I should be showing you how it exactly happening. Understand? So I'm showing you the picture here. So due to the local plastic deformation, so what happens is the particular blowhole or whatever the thing is there, that will get disappear and nullifies the stress concentration effect, because the blowhole is no longer present now. So what happens now? The stress concentration effect nullifies. You're able to understand this thing, everybody? Clear? I'll make you write down. Please just let me know whether you understood what happening experimentally for the first case or not. Okay, so what you guys do is, below this particular table, okay, you can copy this particular table later, okay, you just give some gap, okay, below this, you take this first heading as ductile and static and put this diagram. Put this diagram. Then I will make you write down here. Okay, I can write down here itself. So put this title, diagram and its explanation, okay? So later you can copy about the, you can copy the table, okay? So don't worry about that, just copy this part here. Now, everyone tell me, can we expect this similar type of local yielding in a brittle material under static loading? This only difference or only change I am bringing is, I am replacing this particular ductile metal with a brittle material. So, can I expect this local plastic deformation to happen? Never. Brittle material can never undergo any sort of plastic deformation. Understand? So, we can't expect that. Clear? So, in the previous case, the first case, we understood that though theoretically we have the answer that strength should decrease by a factor kt, but due to local yielding phenomena, the stress concentration effect is being nullified. So, in the first case, strength will remain same. Okay? But this particular local yielding phenomena cannot happen in a brittle material. So, in this case, it will become SUT by KT itself. Any doubt regarding these two cases? Clear? Okay? So, you can write down. I'm rubbing this part here. You write down for brittle under static. Understood? Now listen carefully. We are done with the static loading part. Now we are coming to the dynamic loading part here. Okay? So here, whatever the new strength value has come up, let's take it as S capital E. Okay? So, theoretically speaking, the endurance limit should decrease by this factor kt, okay? So, experimentally it was found that it is not happening like that. So we are expecting the endurance limit to decrease in this way, okay? But it is not the case in this particular real life scenario. It was found experimentally. So, if you check this particular formula, definitely it will be very clear that the mistake or the error will be coming due to KT itself, because KT is the parameter which is not considering material. So anyways, SC is experimental value. So KT is the value which we got it experimentally, but it is not depending upon the material. So error comes from this itself. So what I'm doing is I'm replacing KT with some other factor. It is given as X here. Understand? Okay. So instead of KT, I am using some other factor X, but this X is also decreasing the strength of the material. Is it right? So, SE by X value here. So, it is some other factor, the value is somewhat different, but this is also decreasing the strength here. So, X is also called as stress concentration factor only, but this x will be coming only in this dynamic loading cases. That's the reason why this particular x is given the name as fatigue, stress, concentration factor, and it is denoted by k suffix f. So instead of x, you should be putting k suffix f here. Understand? So I told you that dynamic loading is also called as fatigue loading. So this kf is given the name as fatigue stress concentration factor. Understand? So I'll tell you later how this difference is coming up, what is the value of kf and all these things. Understand? So in real scenario or from experiments, the strength will be changing to se by kf, se by kf. SE by KF. Understood? So kindly copy the table also now. So we'll discuss regarding the remaining factors. Okay? That is not sensitivity. From that we'll understand what is the relation between KF and KT. I'll come to that one. I hope it is clear. If you have a doubt, you can look here. I'm taking a cylindrical specimen. Okay? So some diameter, length and all these things. Let's assume it is made up of, it's having some blowhole like this. It is made up of aluminium. So aluminium, once you decide the material, it will be having some Young's modulus. Okay, you can say it is ductile material and all these things here. It is experiencing load here. Understood? I am taking same geometrically similar component. Let's assume this is made up of glass. Okay? So once you say it is glass, it will be a brittle material. Its value of Young's modulus will be different, all these things will be different. Okay? So now, anyways, load is not required. So if you calculate the value of KT using this thing separately, using any of the experimental techniques which we have discussed, photoelastic technique, etc., you will get the same value of KT because both are geometrically same. Clear now? Mohammed Anas can Danish. So it doesn't matter whether about other parameters are same or not. If you keep dimensions are also different, then automatically you will get different value of KT as well. Okay, now look here. So we are understanding about a concept called as notch sensitivity. It is denoted by Q. So for every material or for a, it is given by the range 0 to 1. Okay, so what exactly is notch sensitivity? Okay, everybody listen carefully. Let's say you have a center lathe machine. So its bed is made up of cast iron. Okay? We are having another center lathe machine. Okay, the only difference is the bed of this particular center lathe machine is made up of cast iron. The bed of the other or second center lathe machine is made up of glass. Okay, this first center lathe machine, this is second center lathe machine, this is made up of cast iron, this is made up of glass. Okay, so let's assume both are having small crack, internal crack is there. At the same location, both are having same. Or same dimension, crack of same dimensions also. Okay, so everything is same. The only difference is this particular bed is made up of cast iron. This particular bed is made up of glass here. Okay, now can you guys tell me which one is more vulnerable or which one is more dangerous, or which is having more tendency to fail fastly? Of course it is glass, because glass is a brittle material and it's going to be very, very weaker. Cast iron is generally stronger, okay, but still we know about glass here. So glass is very, very fragile, so we can expect breakage to happen from this particular second bed of the central lathe machine here. Understand? So bed of the second central lathe machine here. Understood? So you see that both the beds are made up of same type of material, that is same brittle material. Both are brittle materials. Understand? So both are brittle materials. Both are brittle materials. Both are having same type of crack. Everything is same. But still, there is a difference in dangerousness here, or the difference in the probability of failure here. So glass have a tendency of failing faster as compared to a cast iron. The only reason is the sensitivity of a crack for a glass is very high. The sensitivity of a crack for cast iron is very, very less. For example, you have a concrete ceiling. Understand? So if you are sitting in a room, there is a concrete ceiling. Okay, if there is a small crack on the top, okay, little small crack, understand? So you will not feel that the ceiling will fall. Small crack, for example, even we might be seeing cracks on the walls also, okay? But if you are in a room where the ceiling is made up of asbestos, understand? So where the ceiling is made up of asbestos, if there is a crack, means, or imagine you are having a ceiling made up of glass, let's assume. So one room is having a ceiling made up of concrete, or general room basically, whatever, wherever we will be staying, and other room, hypothetical room, where the roof is made up of glass. If there's a crack on the top, you will be always feeling like you'd never ever dare to go and sit inside the particular room. Because we know that sensitivity of a crack for a glass is very high as compared to sensitivity of crack for concrete or some other material. Understand? So you have to understand one very, very important thing, that here every material will have its own tendency towards a crack. Generally, fragile materials will have very high value of notch sensitivity. Fragile materials like glass. Okay? So here you should be understanding or keeping, you should be keeping in mind very, very important thing here. If you take any caster, if you take any central lathe machine, most of the central lathe machines are made up of grey cast iron as their bed. The reason or advantage using that is, if you are using cast iron to make a bed, mostly you will be using casting operation to make a bed. So when you are using casting operation to make a bed, so definitely casting will be giving rise to many defects, internal cracks, blowholes, etc. So, generally in day-to-day life scenario, or if you try to produce any very good material, after casting, forming operation is done to nullify all these blowholes and everything. So, there will be requiring some cost of production. But in a cast iron, as this particular non-sensitivity is very, very less, as the material is very, very sensitive towards this particular, very less sensitive towards this particular notch or this particular internal crack or internal blowhole or whatever it is there. So, this particular cracks or blowholes will not propagate and cause a failure very, very faster. Understood? So, due to that reason, you don't need to do any forming operation to nullify them. Because, as there is very less value of notch sensitivity, or sensitivity of the crack is very, very less, so we don't need to nullify the cracks. So, we can use as it is. Whereas if you use some other type of material, like if you take some steel, etc., so there you have to nullify the cracks, because there might be situation, that might be the situation where sensitivity is high towards a crack. Understand? That is one of the reasons due to which we use this particular cast iron, especially grey cast iron, okay? So this is especially grey cast iron as bed of the central lathe machines. So like Kumar Vishu is telling that, so there is another reason due to which we are going to use grey cast iron as bed of the central lathe machine is, it absorbs, like its damping factor is very, very high, it absorbs vibrations. Okay, its damping coefficient, or if you are going to 3D machines, you will be understanding the particular term, damping coefficient or damping factor, whatever it is. So damping effects are higher, understand? So if this bed is not there, what happens? Due to the rotatory components, etc., it will be trying to vibrate. It will try to vibrate. Imagine you go to or you try to go to tailor shop. He'll be using a sewing machine, right? So when he uses sewing machine at very very high speed, it will be shaking, right? Imagine. Okay, but imagine you are installing this particular sewing machine on a very strong cast iron block, a big cement block. Just imagine. Okay, big cement block is there and you have attached the sewing machine to that particular block on the floor. So, though you are using it for a very high speed, the vibrations are absorbed by the particular big base there. So, the way in which you are using the concrete block at the bottom of the particular sewing machine, here we use this cast iron or grey cast iron block here or the bed here. Understood everybody? Clear? Arupmar, of course, like the definitely in the first place, first of all, that particular sewing machine is designed in such a way using theory of machines concepts and vibration concepts that its rotatory component should not give rise to that amplitude, okay, or that frequency which is equal to natural frequency of that particular component, and that will be making it to dismantle, or due to the vibration itself, it is going to get oscillating very high and eventually breaking out. Understand? So that's how the designing is done. That's the reason why we have to study theory of machines and vibrations. Clear? So after doing that also, slight amount of vibrations will be there, because you see a sewing machine definitely having some amount of vibration. So he tried to keep it on a mat or whatever the way in which he can nullify that existing vibrations to some extent. Okay? Understood everybody? Got the idea? That's the reason why we are going to use grey cast iron as a bed of the central lathe machine. These are the questions which are going to get asked in interviews, PSU interviews. Yeah? So first reason is notch sensitivity. It is having very high notch, it's having less amount of notch sensitivity, less value of Q. Okay, so that helps us to reduce the production cost by eliminating the forming operation or forming procedure. Okay, and second thing is it's having a very high damping coefficient or damping effects. So vibration effects can be nullified to a very greater extent. Okay, everybody? Understood? So this is given by the formula. So this is experimental value, notch sensitivity, experimental value. So this is related with respect to this particular Q is experimental value, please keep in mind, and it is related with respect to KT and KF according to the formula shown on the secondary screen. Okay, so Q is given by KF minus 1 by KT minus 1. KF minus 1 by KT minus 1. It is given mathematically here. Understood? So actually, you know the value of KT from experiments. Understand? You will be taking this particular photoelastic technique method and you will be getting KT value. And Q will be experimentally known. The way in which you will be evaluating Young's modulus, the way in which you will be evaluating strength of the material, yield stress, etc. In the same way, you will be evaluating Q also. Okay? You will be studying about how to evaluate Q in higher studies. So once you know Q and KT, you can easily get KF value. So this formula is actually used in real scenario or in practical scenario to get the value of KF. Understand? It's not that using KF and KT you are going to get the value of Q. It's not the, that's not the meaningful statement. Because Q is an experimental value, KT also an experimental value, but it's having limitation. So using this formula, you are evaluating KF. You are evaluating KF, which is a stress concentration factor, which is considering both a parameter which is depending upon dimensions. It also considering parameter which is depending upon material. Understood? So this particular stress concentration factor is depending upon both material and also dimensions. So we got an appropriate stress concentration factor here. I hope everybody have understood. Clear everybody? Okay? Understood? Lesser the KF, safer the material. Whether you take KF or KT, because both are stress concentration factors. Lesser is the value of KF or KT, lesser is the effect of stress concentration. So, better is the material. So, or lesser is the probability of failure. So, we expect KF, KT values to be lesser. Understood? Even Q value also to be lesser. Of course, once KT is lesser and Q is lesser, automatically we will be getting KF value also to be lesser. Because, if you write down the formula for KF, so KF comes out to be 1 plus Q into KT minus 1. So higher is the value of KT, higher is the value of Q, you'll be getting higher is the value of KF. So if these two dimension parameter, okay, which is depending upon dimensions, this is the metal parameter depending upon material, with these two values are lesser, automatically you'll get the value of KF, which is lesser. Understood? Which is the required objective. Understood everyone? Kindly copy till here. I will write down the advantage of using grey cast iron as bed of the central lathe machine. then we'll go to the next concept. So all these things are explained in the Vivekananda textbook in a very confusing way. So they are not explained in this particular order. It's in a confusing way. Understood? So better understand from here itself. So whenever you feel that you've forgotten about this concept, just take this video once again. So this you'll be having this recorded video. So listen this complete video once again. That's it. Yeah, I will write down. You want to define Q. Okay, so Q is defined as, or non sensitivity is defined as, sensitivity of a material towards a notch or a crack is called as notch sensitivity. Understood? Q depends only on the material. Just like Young's modulus, rigidity modulus, bulk modulus, Poynings ratio, Q is also a metal property. Just like density, thermal conductivity, etc., Q is also a metal property. So after this, we'll just give him a definition to KF and then we'll go ahead. Mohammed, Anaska and Danish, you are still having confusion regarding the difference between stress induced in a material and strength of a material. So I've given you an example at the starting of this today's lecture. If you say a person's capacity is to carry 70 kg load, okay? So till you give him a weight of 70 kg, he'll be able to carry. Okay, so a person is there, imagine a person is standing, okay? So, or you imagine a person as me itself. So I can carry a weight of 70 kg, clear? So if you give me 50 kg, I will carry. If you give me 60 kg, I will carry. If you give me 69 kg, I will carry. Understand? So the inducer stress is like this, 50, 60, 69, all these are inducer stresses. So you apply some load that will be giving rise to stress. Understand? That can be any value. So when this induced stress is more than the strength of the material, so this 60 kg or 69 kg, instead of giving whatever the weight you are giving to me, which is 50, 60, 69, instead of these three values or any other value which is less than 70, if you are giving me more than 70, I will not be able to carry that. Eventually, I will fail. Understood? So that is the strength of the material. Understand? So strength is 70 kg here. Whatever you give, that's induced stress. So we expect induced stress to be less than the strength of the material. So if you don't want me to fail, means you should be giving me a weight which is less than 70 kg, right? In the same way, every metal will be having some value of strength. You should be inducing stress which is less than the strength of the material. Understood? Now when you are defining this KT, we have defined KT as sigma max or sigma nominal. These two are both induced stresses. Understand? This is the induced stress with stress concentration. This is the induced stress without stress concentration. Understand, there is nothing which is strength value here. Understood? In fact, this affects the strength value. Clear? So I hope it is completely clear now. Other people also, I hope it is clear now at least. Okay, so before going into a numerical, so let's look into the definition of KF. Understand? So because there's one type of definition given in this particular V.B. Bhandari textbook, which is given like this directly. Engerrance limit of notched free specimen by engerrance limit of notched specimen. This thing should be very, very clear. Otherwise, if you open the textbook, you'll not be understanding what exactly they mean by this particular definition. Okay? So everybody please pay attention here. Let's take this particular formula. This particular formula here. So, where Kf is there. Okay? So, from this one, I can write down that Kf value is equal to S small e by S capital E. Can you guys tell me the difference between S small e and S capital E? What is the difference between S small and S capital E here? Very easy. Look here. S small e is the strength of a material under dynamic loading without stress concentration. Okay? This is for the case where with stress concentration. So if you write down this definition here, so it is anyways endurance limit here. Endurance limit without stress concentration by endurance limit with stress concentration. So you have to keep in mind that it is endurance limit without stress concentration by endurance limit with stress concentration. Clear? Now, when stress concentration will occur? Stress concentration will occur when there is some notch, when there is some blowhole, when there is some internal crack, etc. So something should be there which is causing stress concentration. To study stress concentration, we generally create notches because we cannot create internal crack, we cannot create blowhole, etc. Because all these things are naturally occurring defects. Notch we can make it. To study about stress concentration, we make notch for a specimen. So we can write another way that endurance limits of notch free specimen by endurance limits of notched specimen. So if you would like to get the value of Kf directly without going with the formula, because you have Kf is equal to 1 plus Q into Kf Kt minus 1. So if you are going with this formula, you have to get the value of Kt separately. You have to do this experiment. You have to get the value of Q also experimentally, and then you have to substitute in the formula here. Understand? So if you'd like to not use this particular formula, you can go ahead with this. You do the same loading condition by taking two specimens which are completely same, but one is having a notch, another one is not having a notch. So if you just take the difference or ratio of this particular endurance limit, you'll be getting the value of Kf. But anyways, it is not required for gate point of view, because in a gate examination, they will give you all these values of Kf, Q, Kt, etc. At least out of these three, they'll give you two values so that other value can be calculated. Because you cannot do or evaluate any value experimentally in the examination. So that's the reason why you have this particular definition textbook. In fact, the V.B. Bhandari textbook starts with this particular formula. Okay, so which is the formula which you should be knowing at the end of the class or end of the concept here. So that's the reason why I feel it is not in the best structured way. So you guys can go with this lecture to understand about this particular concentration, stress concentration effects and variation of strength values due to this particular stress concentration effect. Okay, everybody? Clear? So you guys can copy and then you guys can solve this question. So give the answer for option A, B, C and D. Very simple question, just to make you people to understand how to apply this particular concept to the numerical here. That's it. Kindly apply, everyone. So this particular values will be same for both ductile and ductile and brittle. Yes, mathematically speaking, the formula will remain same. But here, this Kf value will be depending upon material and dimensions, right? So depending upon the material you are choosing, that material will be having some value of Q and everything. So you'll be getting the value correspondingly, automatically or accordingly there, okay? In the same way for this one also, clear? The formula, like for you, you're actually observing the formula. Formula will remain same, but the value will come depending upon the material itself, clear? Okay, so this particular question is very simple. So I just given to make you get used with this particular formula here. It's given that a material is having an yield strength of 294 MPa when considering it as ductile, ultimate strength as 300 MPa when considering it as brittle. Okay, hypothetical material. Okay, so you should consider yield strength as 294 when you are dealing with or considering it as ductile material. You should take ultimate strength as 300 MPa when it is considered as brittle material. Endurance strength of 196 MPa. So SE, so they are giving it as 196 MPa. So SYT value is given as 294. SUT value is equal to given as 300 megapascal. SE value is given as 196 megapascal. They are given the theoretical stress concentration factor as KT is equal to 1.5, and you have non sensitivity Q as 0.5. Okay, so Q value should be lying from 0 to 1. Okay, it should not be going beyond 1. Now find the failure stress when ductile under static loading. So when ductile under static loading, it is equal to SYT. So this becomes simply 294. Now this one, if you check it, it is SUT by KT. 300 by 3 by 2. So this becomes 200 megapascal. Understand? In the same way, for using this particular two formula, you have to get the value of Kf. So using these two, get the value of Kf. So Kf is equal to 1 plus Q is 0.5 into Kf minus 1. 1.5 minus 1. So 1.5 minus 1, 0.5. So this becomes 1.25. So 1.25 means SE 196 by 1.25. That is how you have to get the answer for all these four cases here. Understood? So very simple question. Answer this question here. Next one. Yeah, 156.8 is the right answer only for the last two cases.